if the savers can struggle to access their money, how are we going to build confidence in the other Ugandans, the majority who are not covered by social security, to even pick appetite to join it?
The Mwine Mpaka-led committee kicked off the inquiry with testimony from a whistleblower known as John Richard Motoa, who pinned management of the National Social Security Fund for running the entity with selfish motives by investing savers' money in non-profitable ventures. Motoa told the Mwine Mpaka-led committee that NSSF injected 1.251 trillion shillings in a real estate project in Dowowa on Entebbe Road, but houses are too expensive to be afforded by workers and not to make profits for the fund.
Honorable Chair, we have housing estate project in Lubowa. 2,700 housing units are planned to be built there. They have completed 300 of them, 300 units. None of those houses can be afforded by any of the savers of NSSF. How much are they? 3 billion, 2 billion, 1.5 billion.
Motoa also mentioned other NSSF real estate projects in Temangalo, where NSSF sank savers' money but didn't make any profit for the fund. He noted that most of these projects stalled, hence making it difficult for them to make profits for savers.
What makes the workers' money meaningful is the big interest it earns. If I put my 10,000 there, in 20 years, I want to find it 1 million. It would have been protected in terms of value. But I put my 10,000 there, and then it grows to 20,000, then you want me to clap for you, I will not.
Motoa also turned to the embattled former managing director of NSSF, Richard Byarugaba, whom he accused for exempting some organizations like Uganda Railway Corporation from remitting arrears of NSSF contributions for their workers, hence causing loss to workers.
7 years down the road, their NSSF money has not reached the workers' house. Sincerely speaking, Honorable Chair, 9 billion Uganda Railways, there's a case of Uganda Railway, 9 billion. Uganda Railway had accumulated 9 billion of savers' money, Honorable Chair. This money was waived off by the former MOD of NSSF. The money was waived off.
The whistleblower also punched holes in the way Dr. Byarugaba's contract had been renewed after clocking the retirement age. He asserted that it was illegally done since he had even completed his two-term limit.
The board of NSSF, I can say, failed to supervise the management, and the management took advantage of that to run the affairs the way it can do, together with the board. That is where the problem is. In fact, it could be the reason as to why the same impunity board went ahead to recommend somebody past retirement age, somebody who has served past the legal framework, to be reappointed.
To go back, get all the documentation,
yes,
organize it properly.
Yes.
For each allegation, you must have evidence to support that allegation.
Yes.
And you will let us know which time is appropriate for you to appear back in this committee, and we shall accord you the same time.
Yes.
But when you are more organized with all those documents you are referring to that you can get.
The National Organization of Trade Unions also appeared before the committee and has called for re-evaluation of the real estate investments of the National Social Security Fund to suit the needs of the contributors. According to the union, the 1.1 trillion investment in real estate for the year ended 2021 is at risk, and workers cannot afford the houses.
The biggest risk, if you analyze, it is in real estate as per now. That's why you are hearing stories of Temangalo, you are hearing stories of Lubowa. So the money at stake currently is 1.1 trillion. So in our view, we feel that there is no money which is there to be thrown to the dogs. Still, this 1.1 trillion which is at stake, this is workers' money.
Okello said that the fund constructed houses in Lubowa on Entebbe Road, with each house costing approximately 3 billion shillings. He urged the committee to recommend construction of affordable houses, saying that it's the only sure way of making returns on investments while benefiting those who contribute to the fund.
How the fund is being used or managed at NSSF, but what is the status of the workers' savings? The third question is, have you ever used any money from the fund?
I would be interested to know whether you're conversant as a workers' union, whether you're conversant of the number of your members that are savers to the fund.
Under any parliamentary intervention through this committee to strengthen operations of the fund is highly welcome and shall be supported by ourselves as workers' leaders.
Report compiled by Fred Kajubi for the news.